He knows he wants us to rejoice in this day and be glad in it for what the Lord has given to us. We've come to worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. And we're glad that you're here this morning with us to worship. And be sure on those connection cards, everybody, sign them. If you got a prayer request, fill it out. Tomorrow morning at 9, we have several of us meeting here, and we pray over those requests that you fill out. And all the people that's here all the time, our tenders, you just put it into the offering when we take that up here in just a little bit. If you're a first-time guest, fill out everything, keep it, hold on to it, and at the end of the service, when you go out at the table here, we'll have somebody here to give you a guest packet, all right, that you can gift, that you can take home with you. And we're glad that each and every one of you is here today so we can come together and worship the Lord. Hallelujah. And I do want to mention we will have communion today at the end, towards the end of our service. We will open, our communion is open to anyone who is a believer. If you're a born-again believer and you know Jesus Christ, your Savior, then we invite you to come at the end of this service today when we take communion and take it together with us as we were reminded of what the Lord has done for us. Amen? And we praise the Lord for that. So keep that in mind. Also, don't forget tonight, there'll be no evening service here. We'll be worshiping at Grace United Methodist Church uptown. It's our Unite service. It's going to be a great service. Heather, you involved? I didn't get a chance to talk to you, but you're going to be doing some stuff there as well tonight. Heather will be. And
Jimmy so, and Dale also will be
and
there.
Jimmy and Dale, okay. Mm-hmm. And because I haven't had a chance to, I talked to her real quick when I was getting ready to get on a plane, and that was about the end of that, and then let her get with Nikki Farmer and straighten it out. But Brother Phil Russell, the pastor of the Christian Heritage, will be bringing the message tonight. It's going to be a worship service. We're going to have a great time. And you guys, Sunday nights, come out. Let's join together and unite as a body in Kokomo so people can know that us believers are coming together. We're one church. Amen. We're not just a denomination. We are one church. Amen. Denominations, God does, you know, it doesn't matter to him. Hello. What really matters to him, that you are a part of the family of God, that you belong to him. That's the priority. General Baptist ain't going to get you to heaven. Pentecost ain't going to get you to heaven. Nazarene, Methodist, that ain't going to get you to heaven. But Jesus Christ will. And that's what we're talking about. Amen? So come out. I know things may be a little different, not what you're used to here, but you know, we got to get past those things and come for one thing, and that's to worship God. That's what we're there to do. And that's what we're here to do this morning. And that's what we're going to do tonight when we go to Grace. We're going to go in there and we're going to worship the Lord. Pastors are going to be sitting together praying during the service, and we're going to unite, amen, and be as one. So that'll be at 6 o'clock tonight, our evening service. And then don't forget, next Sunday is Mother's Day. Can you believe it? Man. And we'll be recognizing our mothers next Sunday, and be a great time. And there'll be no evening service of Mother's Day. And then in 2 weeks, on the 15th, that Sunday night, the 15th at 6 o'clock, on our evening worship service, we'll be ordaining Jordan Wilson, and we'll be praying over him and Dale, as Dale will be reinstated in his ordination as well, Dale Fouts here, our bass player. So it's going to be a special night in 2 weeks on Sunday night, the 15th. So you don't want to miss that either. And we'll have a cake, and we're going to have sandwiches and stuff afterwards in the fellowship hall. Right after the service that Sunday night. So it'll be a great night. So mark that down and keep that handy for you, okay? And then we're going to be having a movie night on the 22nd of May. And we're planning on showing Woodlawn. I don't know if how many of you have ever seen that. Good movie. And we'll be showing that. A great movie. All righty? So let's just stand together. Amen. And let's just take a little time to go around and greet one. Oh, I want to say last night, I want to mention it. Thank you, Susie. Last night we had our chicken and noodle dinner for a fundraiser. And man, I went out to do a delivery with Jerry Kuhn and I, and we come back. I said, man, where are we going to park? You know, there was cars coming over everywhere. And we raised over $1,000 last night. Amen? Yes. In that. And thank the Lord. Yes. And we won $1,090 right now. Yes. And there's extra bakes and stuff out in the foyer when you leave. If you want to give a donation for that and take that home with you, please do that. It's out there in the foyer, what's left. And please do that today when you leave. All righty? And so let's take this time, and we want to thank everybody for getting involved and helping Sue and them and Becky and doing all this. A lot of work behind it, and we just thank the Lord for that. And God is so good. So let's take this time now to come. Yes, the new members classes will be starting one up on May the 15th. May the 15th, Sunday evening at 4:45 in the adult classroom over here. They will be having a membership class. And next week I'll have a sign-up sheet. If you think you're interested in going into that, it's about an hour long, and we have six of those spread out. We'd love for you to come, and that way you can get to know more about the church and everything what's involved there, okay? So just let us know, and like I said, I'll have a sheet next week that you can fill out, so they'll have an idea of anybody that's coming for that. We want to open the doors each month to start that for anybody that might be interested in taking those classes. It doesn't mean you have to join, but taking the classes, you can get an idea of what it's about, all right? Okay, all right, let's take the time now just to fellowship one another, and we're glad you're here today. Praise the Lord.
Ready? One, two, ready, go.
Garfield up here in a few minutes and have him to come, and he's gonna share some scripture with us and lead us in a word of prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. How many's glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Amen. And how many knows if you're iffy, God can make a difference this morning for you? Amen. Hallelujah. This is a great day. I'm telling you, every day is a good day regardless. Whether it's foggy, raining, sunshine, God is always the same. He's still there, isn't he? Amen? And I'm glad for that. I'm glad he's the same yesterday, today, and forever for each and every one of us. Go ahead, Garvin.
While our brother was praying, speaking about the service tonight, you know, it reminded me years ago I heard this one. I got to share it with you. There were these different ministers together, you know, and they was telling, well, I'm a Methodist, I'm a Baptist, I'm a Presbyterian, I'm this, I'm that. But you know, when we get to heaven, there will not be Baptists, Methodists, Presbyterians, Catholics. We'll all be united brethren. Took a while, didn't it? It took a while.
Boy, watch him. He shaved his mustache this week. He's on a roll.
Yeah. Oh, the Lord is good. Let's stand, please. I like what they say in England. It says, everybody upstanding. Everybody upstanding. All right. Bless the Lord. Let me read this to you this morning. Just a short scripture. I will bless the Lord at all times. I will praise. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. That's where I want to finish. Magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Let's pray. Father, we rejoice today and thank you, for great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Lord, we thank you for your multiple benefits that you've given to us. Lord, you daily load us with your benefits. So, Father, this morning, it's our privilege to gather together in this place and say, great is the Lord. We worship you. We magnify you this morning. Lord, let everything that is said and done in this service bring honor and glory to thee, O Lord. Bless the music. Bless our praise. Bless the ministry of the word, Lord. That, Lord, everything the Holy Spirit may use to just draw people to Christ. Lord, it is our prayer that the name of our church should not just be a name, just a name, but the actuality of we are in the image of Jesus Christ, and we reflect that image to all people. And when people drive by here, they shall be drawn to Jesus Christ. And when they come into this place, they'll be drawn to him who says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Lord, for those in this morning, you know each of our hearts. You know, Lord, where there's it might be a downtime for some. And Lord, I pray that you'll reach down and lift them up. And Lord, there may be some living on the mountaintop. We rejoice in that with them. And Lord, there may be those here who do not know you. They know church. They may know religion. But they may not yet know you as their own personal Savior from sin. And may the Holy Spirit just speak to their hearts this morning and reveal to them that they must give their hearts to Jesus Christ. And Lord, we will praise you and thank you for all of this. We ask it in the name of our Lord Jesus, and we praise you with the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hallelujah. We're going to have our ushers to come at this time as we take up our morning tithes and offerings. And as we do this, I do want to mention too, next Saturday morning, there is going to be a men's breakfast here at our church. It's been rotating at different churches, different men coming in together. We have a breakfast and have a time to share together. There'll be a devotion given, and it's just a good time of fellowshipping together in the Lord. And so we invite anybody, any men that wants to come. That will be at 10 a.m. That starts at 10 a.m. next Saturday, and that will be in our fellowship hall for this time. That's where it's going to be. Bless you. Heavenly Father God, we thank you again for this offering we're about to take. And we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have to come into your house and to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, bless this offering. Bless each and every one as we give today, as you have blessed us. We want to, in return, give blessings to you. And God, we just thank you and praise you, and we just ask that your presence will continue to come in and fill this place. Fill each and every heart in this room, God, that we can worship you. And God, we want to give you the praise and the glory for these things and all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Brother Rick, would you come up and bless us with a song?
Living below in this so simple world, hardly a comfort can I afford. Striving alone to face temptation, so now won't you tell me where could I go back to the Lord? Where could I go? Oh, where could I go? Seeking a refuge for my soul, needing a friend to save me in the end. Won't you tell me where could I go back to the Lord? Life here is grand with friends I love so dear. Comfort I get from God's own word. When I face that chilling hand of death, won't you tell me where could I go back to the Lord? Where could I go? Seeking a refuge for my soul, needing a friend to save me in the end. Won't you tell me where could I go? To the Lord. Where could I go back to the Lord?
Amen, amen. Thank you, Rick. That was awesome. Well, everybody stand to your feet. It's time to give our praise.
It's time to give the glory and the honor to the one who came to the earth just to save us and bring us back to him again someday. So let's sing every praise to him. What Garfield was saying today about praise, let's think about that as we sing this song. One, two, ready, go.
Every grace, every grace, you are. Yeah. Oh, our voices. Voices, take a minute and just praise the Lord. Nothing but praises. Praises from your heart. Praises from that prostrate position of the heart, where there's nothing else but Him. Father, we praise you.
Lord, we praise you.
We have in Jesus, and you know, we have a friend, and he's here right now. I don't know what he's wanting to do, but he's doing something here in this house today. And this song I'm going to do, the Lord gave me a few years ago, and it talks about not letting Jesus pass your way. Jesus is in the house. He's here right now. And I went out of Luke's Gospel, the 19th chapter with Zacchaeus, and also the 10 lepers in the 17th chapter. And God gave me these words, and He's here. And if He's speaking to your heart, you don't have to wait till the sermon's over. You can come right now. The day, right now is the time. Now's the time for you. You don't need to wait for what God wants to do in your life. Because we never know what tomorrow brings. But we do have today, right now. We have the present. And He's here. His presence is here. So you listen to the word. Don't let Jesus pass your way this last time.
If there's anybody in this church that's not saved, we don't know what tomorrow's going to bring.
Man.
And you don't know if you're going to be here tomorrow. 8 months ago tonight, my husband went to bed. And when I went in to get him up, He was already gone. He didn't know, and I didn't know, that he wouldn't see tomorrow.
Yes.
So please don't wait, because don't take that chance.
Amen.
I just felt like I had to say that today.
Yes. Thank you, Fanny. Thank you very much. Yes. Hallelujah.
I'm telling you. Church, he is here. I don't know how else
yes,
to say
it. Yes, amen. Yes, he is.
I don't have pretty words for you,
yes.
But he's here. And I'm telling you what, if you've got anything in your life that's keeping you from fully experiencing the power of the Holy Ghost,
yes.
If you have sin in your life, and I'm going to call them out. If you're looking at things you shouldn't be looking at.
That's right.
If you're saying things you shouldn't be saying. If you're doing things you shouldn't be doing, then today is the day to lay that stuff down at the feet of Jesus.
Yes, amen.
And be a spotless bride for him. Today is the day.
Yes.
And I don't care if you're five. I don't care if you're 95.
That's right.
Today is the day.
Absolutely.
And he loves us all the same, and he wants us all the same. Today is the day.
Hallelujah.
A good friend of mine passed away this week, suddenly. He and his wife were traveling down here on 22. I sat by him in choir for many years, many services. Talked to him, had the same conversations. Just like that, they were gone. Just like that. A good friend of mine's cousin, pastor's wife down here at the One Accord Church.
Mm-hmm.
She passed away last night.
Yes.
You don't know. Just like our sister said, you do not know when your time is up. You don't have time to keep those things in your heart.
Right.
You don't have time to keep that dirt in your life.
That's right.
Okay, you can't be clean on Sunday and half clean Monday through Saturday.
That's right.
We can't
Amen.
Do it. That's not the kind of church that God wants.
That's right. Amen.
That's not the bride that pleases him.
Yes.
We've got to do it every day, every minute, all the time.
Yes.
We need to be so clean that God can speak to us in our sleep and tell us what he wants us to do. We need to be that clean. And he can do that.
Yes, he can.
I'm going to tell you what, we don't know when he's coming back.
That's right.
And we don't know when our time on earth is done.
That's right.
But one thing we do know, if we are washed by the blood of the Lamb, and we work and press toward the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus.
Amen.
We have nothing to worry about. But I'm going to tell you what, if you're treading on that boundary, you're treading on dangerous water.
That's right. Amen.
Get your life right. If you need to get it right, get it right.
Amen. Hallelujah. Can we stand together? Yeah, go ahead, Gene. Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, there is. Yes, there is. Yes.
He is here.
To the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide his word in my heart that I might not sin against God. Hallelujah. We're going to Acts chapter 16 today. Acts chapter 16. We're turning right there for just a few moments. We're still, you know, we've been dealing with the presence-based church, the presence of God. You know, the presence of God is more than anything. Amen. Without his presence, we have nothing. Amen. Praise God. You know, the question in the presence-based church is not that we are attracting people, but rather we are attracting the presence of God. I'm going to read that again. This is important. It's not that people's not important. God wants people to come to his house. But here's the thing, and this is what the problem is in society and even in the church. But here it is. The question in the presence-based church is not, are we attracting people, but rather, are we attracting the presence of God? Did you get a hold of that? It's not that we're attracting people. It ain't about people. It is about people, but it's not. He's not the main people's not the main focal point. People come and say, "Well, I like this church because they do this or they do that." That's not the reason why you should be here. If that's the reason why you're here for the wrong reason. Your sole and prime purpose is to seek the presence of God and be hungry for Him, that His presence shows up. If he doesn't, I don't care what kind of music you got. I don't care how good the preacher is. If he doesn't show up, who cares? Get a hold of that. Amen? Do you agree with that? That's the reason why we come. We come to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen? And his presence, that's what we want. It doesn't matter. Praise God. I mean, over in London, they went almost a year without music. Just finally to realize that they need to seek the presence of God. A church. And you know what happened? God's presence came in and filled that place. Because they were seeking the right thing. Amen? And that's when the worship leader there wrote the song. You know, we're going, getting back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. That's where that song came about. Hallelujah. Because they decided to get back to where they were worshiping and seeking the presence of God, that God's presence would come in the midst of them. Isn't that awesome? And it doesn't matter what the circumstances is. And that's why, Lord, he's directed me here, and I want to share something that we've heard many, many times, probably this scripture, in Paul and Silas. But I want you to look at this verse in verse 25. And before we get to that, let's look at verse 23. Let's just look at verse, and I'm sorry, I've messed everything up today, the screen and all that stuff, you know, but that's why you need to have your Bibles with you, amen? That way you can get it regardless, all right? But anyways, in the 16th chapter of Acts, verse 23, and when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in stocks. Not only in behind the bars, but their feet were fastened. Today they'd protest. Enough of that, anyways. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns and singing praises to God. Hallelujah. And the prisoners were listening to them. Once you get a hold of that. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's chains were loosed. And the keeper of prison, waking from sleep and seeing that the prison doors were open, supposing that the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. And Paul called with a loud voice, said, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." And they called for a light. And he fell down trembling before them and before Paul and Silas, and he brought them out, and he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" He didn't say go to a church for a year and then pray. He didn't say teach a Sunday school class. Amen. And all these things I'm saying, they're good. There's nothing wrong with those things I'm saying. So don't get me wrong. But that's not what it takes. Amen. But here's what it is. He said to him, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved." That's what changes a life. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your presence, God. Would you just give us a few minutes, Lord, of your presence continually here, Lord, to share from our hearts to the people, Lord, of your holy word and what your scriptures is saying to us today as you have spoken to us. Lord, we're thankful for that midnight hour, that no matter when it is, how hard things get, God, you're there. You seek your people. You desire for your people to worship you, to praise you, to pray, to call upon you, to seek you, Lord. And Lord, when they do, Lord, you show up, thank God. Eventually, Lord, there's a time and there's a season. And God, we just praise you and thank you, God, that your presence is here today. And we give you the glory and the honor for these things we ask in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Hallelujah. At the midnight hour, praise God. Paul and Silas was in prison and they didn't deserve to be. They didn't even deserve to be in prison. But there they are. They're in prison because he cast out a demon in a girl that was demonic. Amen. It was a fortune teller. And the people were upset because they lost their income. And because they lost their income, they turned on Paul and Silas and accused them of things. And you know, the accuser's always a liar. Are you here? The accuser of the brother, that's the devil. I'm here to tell you, the devil's here to accuse you every day. He'll lie against you when you stand for the truth of Jesus Christ. Can I hear an amen? But I'm here to tell you, church, in these last days, you better take a stand and you better stand on Jesus, because in the last days, it's going to become an awful religious world of Christianity, Catholics, and Islam. In the last day, it's going to come down to a halt and God's going to come and judge the whole world, plus the religious system that's about to come our way. If you want more of that coming the fall, we're going to be studying Revelation. I'll give it all to you. I've even got more. It just opens your eyes. It's just unbelievable. And we're in that time, people. We're in that time, and we've got to stand for Jesus. Our faith has to be secure and grounded in him. As Heather was talking about, if you've got anything in your life, repent of it. Lay it down. It's not worth it. Anything. It's not worth it to fuss over somebody else or to argue with somebody else. We've got to build the kingdom of God. We're in the last days. We've got to love one another and love Christ as he first loved us. Hallelujah. Because that's what Paul and Silas did. They stood on a firm foundation. They were locked up. They were bound in chains, but they didn't feel sorry for themselves. They didn't get down and out and say, "Oh me, why am I here? I just did what you wanted me to do. Lord, look where I'm at." No, they sang praises at midnight. All they could do is say, "Lord, we're here for your kingdom. The God that brought that demon out is the God that can deliver us." We've got to understand understand that, church, that we're in a world and we're fighting against the principalities of the air. But praise God, greater is he that is inside of you than he that's in this old world. God has come to raise you up for such a time as this. Can I hear an amen? I'm here to tell you, church, you've got to know that. And if you're not on a firm foundation, you will backslide and fall in these last days. Amen. Are you here? This ain't the usual. I'm not the usual. I just give what the Holy Spirit of God wants me to give. I'm giving it to you. You take it wherever you want to. Amen? But I'm here to tell you, in the last days, there's going to be a falling away. The Bible tells you. I wish I had better news for you. But the good news is, those that hold on to Christ and endure to the end, so shall be saved. He that endureth to the end, so shall be saved. Hallelujah. You better have your foundation on the foundation. Paul and Silas had on the foundation. They were there. Man, I'll tell you, even in chains, even though they were bound physically, they wasn't bound spiritually. Hallelujah. I'll tell you, they can do everything to you physically, but they can't do anything to you spiritually and what you got inside with Jesus. Are you here today? Hallelujah. No matter what they want to do. Praise God, at the midnight hour, they begin to pray to the God that they knew could raise them up. They begin to worship him. They begin to sing praises at midnight. In the midnight hour, they begin to sing up to God. And when they begin to worship God and praise him, everybody else in the cell block was still, and they were listening to Paul and Silas as the worship was going forth to the one and true and living God. I'm telling you something, folks. When you begin to get a genuine worship of God, and your mind's not on somebody else or what's happening in the church, but you just want to seek God's presence and you just want God to come and fill you, it'll change the atmosphere. It'll not only change your life inside, but it'll change those around you. It'll make a difference. I'm here to tell you, any other time that jail would loose, everybody would leave. But when the presence of God came in, the jailhouse rocked and opened, but nobody left. Are you here? When the presence of God came in, nobody left. You can read it. Man, he rocked that place. He loosened their bonds. The doors were open. In other words, I've come to set the captives free. I've come to free those who want to be free that worship me. And if you want freedom, you want healing, you want deliverance, you worship God. It goes back to the heart of worship. It's not about what you got on. I ain't got a tie on. I hope nobody's offended. Lord, have mercy. Isn't that a sad day? We want to describe people and what they look like. Or, well, you sure don't look like a preacher. What's he supposed to look like? Hello? Are you in the house? It's funny. And amazing how we can describe in our minds, amen, that there's someone far above us, far greater, woo, than you could ever imagine. And I can only imagine, I love that song, I can only imagine what it's going to be like, amen. It ain't going to be anything like I'm thinking. It's even going to be far better. It's going to be far greater. And when they worshiped the jailhouse rock, praise God, Elvis thought he had something. Man, it was written a long time ago. Amen. Hallelujah. The jailhouse rock long before Elvis ever sung it. You know what I mean? Woo! And boy, did it rock in the presence of God. And their bands were loosed. And you got to understand, people's probably wondering, well, why did the Philippian jailer want to kill himself? Because he was going to die anyways, because if all them left, he was responsible. And if you allow prisoners to go, the punishment is death. So now maybe that gives you a greater understanding. When he seen that the doors were open, when he woke up, he assumed everybody's gone. Are you here? And he took his sword and he was about to kill himself. But instead of losing his life, he got life. Are you with me? I said instead of losing his life, he got life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because the man was in the house, and the Apostle Paul, he looked at the jailer and said, hey, don't harm yourself. You don't need to do anything. We're all here, praise God. There's not a one left. God showed up. We've come to worship him. He's the one that has freed us. And when he shined that light and walked about, he realized what the power of God had done. And he looked at Paul and he said, what must I do to be saved? What do I need to do to be saved? Hallelujah. And it's really simple, but yet so powerful. Amen. I said it's a simple gospel, but it's a powerful gospel. Good news. I said, what, Paul, what must I do to be saved? Amen. He didn't give him a big list. Amen. Like some people doing church. Well, now, you know, he got saved. Got to do this, and that. Listen to me. Just let God live. I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to tell you what real life does change. And the family's here today, but my neighbor, I don't want to get into names. I'll get this on radio, but my neighbor, he got saved. And I want you to know something. Once he got done praying, he got saved. I didn't ask him. I didn't have to ask him to go to church. I want you to catch that. I never had to ask him one time, you need to find your church. You know what's the first thing that came out of his mouth when he got saved and the peace of God was all over him? He looked at this pastor here and he said, Pastor, you're in that new building now, aren't you? I said, yes, I am. He said, I'll be there Sunday. And he was. He's went home to be with the Lord now, but he was here. What am I saying? I'm saying this. When Jesus comes in, he comes in. And he begins to work on the individual, and then we help him grow, amen. But it's not a list of do's and don'ts, folks. Amen? It's God's wonderful grace that wants to come into a person and fill them with his spirit. That they can walk in him. And they can walk in him and then they can have others to help lead them. That's what teachers are for. That's what Sunday school teachers or any other teacher are for. It's here to lead you to grow in Christ. It's here to lead you to the Word of God. That the Word of God can become plain and known unto you. And it's his Holy Spirit that's in you. As you hear that, will increase your faith and knowledge in the Lord Jesus Christ to be what you need to be. Amen? So what must I do to be saved? And Paul simply said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Simply put your faith in Jesus Christ and him alone. Don't put it in circumcision, because there's all kinds of stuff going on back into. Oh, now you got to circumcise yourself too, brother. Amen. We got all this other junk we want to throw at him. We need to get it out the window. I'm sorry. If I offend somebody, tough. You need Jesus. And when you really get Jesus, you'll have everything. Now, you won't know everything, but you'll have everything. And the one that you have that's everything will come into your life, and he will begin to walk with you. I love what Steve Shue said last week. God just told him, walk with me. Just walk with him. And we're here to encourage one another as we walk in him. Amen? That's why we have what we have, so we can grow in the Lord. And that's why you have this Bible every day. Don't keep it on the shelf. Open it up and let God speak to you. Let God minister to you. Man, Paul was letting God minister to him. They worshiped God and God showed up. What must it? Believe on the Lord Jesus. And he believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. And not only did he believe, but his whole household got saved. Hallelujah. They come to the knowledge of the Lord and were saved. And it's hard telling. Who else might have got saved through all that stuff? It's not even recorded. We don't know how many of them jailers actually turned their life over to God eventually. Just because it ain't recorded doesn't mean it didn't happen. I'll tell you one thing. They sure didn't leave the jailhouse. And they sure had an opportunity to. Are you here? Because all the jails were open, not just theirs. He opened them all. Not a one. We're all here. We are all here. Amen. Well, it's amazing what God can do when you open your heart to Him. And it all starts with His presence and coming before Him in worship. It all starts with the heart. It's not about circumstances. We all go through things and go through different things. We go through hardships and everything. But you know what? He's still worthy to be worshiped. He's the one. If you're going to come out of this stuff, He's the one that's going to bring you out. He's the one that's going to bring you out. In the midnight hour when things get tough, just lift your hands unto the Lord. Pray to Him. Lay down, like we said, whatever you got to do. But welcome Him into your life and worship Him and know that He's the one and only in your life. And when you do, I'll tell you, He's going to show up in your life. He's going to help you when it seems like you got no help. Here He comes. He's always right on time. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory to God, He's on time. He's on time. And He's there to reach out and save a soul. See, your light it makes a difference. It's the way you live makes a difference. And I'll tell you, you keep letting your light shine. There'll be people coming to you, want to talk to you. Amen. Hallelujah. Why? Because God's in these last days wants to pour out His Spirit and touch lives of people. Amen. He does. And He's here today. He's here today. We're going to get ready to take communion in a little bit, but He's here today. And whatever your need is, we're going to play a little response to make sure everybody's heart, you're clear with Him. Because if you're not a believer, you don't want to take this. This is one part that is for believers only. When Jesus ministered to everybody, but when He did His supper, He did it only with His followers. Nowhere do I read that He did it anywhere else. He told them to go up there in the last days when He's about to go to the cross and prepare. Amen? And prepare for this meal that we will take together. And in that, the one betrayed Him. Amen? Amen? And left. And they finished the course there and went on and went out to the Mount of Olives. They prayed and tarried, and He had them to pray with Him, and some of them slept. And He said, well, can you not tarry 1 hour? And He just continued, and finally the hour came. And Jesus gave Himself up. But remember, as we said last week, His presence was so heavy, they even fell over before they could take Him. But He willingly surrendered Himself because He was doing the will of the Father to give Himself up for us. Amen. He went through all the punishment for us. Hallelujah. What more would you want? Amen. He did it for you, for each and every one of us. He's a great God. That's why Paul and Silas sang when they sang, regardless of where they are. They didn't protest and say, why did I got these bonds and chains? And why ain't they feeding me right? I'm in this jail. Hello. Are you here? Like what one sheriff said down in Southern Indiana, I didn't ask him to come here. Hello. I don't know what your view is, but I'll tell you this. God's a great God. He's here to save the individual. It doesn't matter where our circumstance is. What's important is where our heart is. Is where our heart is. And as a church, I'm here to encourage you. We've got to get on fire for the Lord, and we've got to draw and have a passion for Him, because we are in the latter days, folks. We are there. It's coming. Let's get ready. Let's reach out. Let's praise Him with all that we have, and let's encourage others to come in to the kingdom. Amen? Let them get saved before they get here. Amen? Do your work out there in the streets, hallelujah, and bring them in. Amen? Hallelujah. He's here. Even in the midnight hour, He'll show up. He'll show up. It's all about the heart of worship. Amen? getting back to the heart of worship. We hear His presence here today. He has filled this place. He's in the house right now. As we prepare for communion, we want to take time to pray, because there may be someone here that just needs to pray. Maybe there's someone here that hasn't drawn themselves to that relationship with Jesus. This is your opportunity. This Holy Spirit's drawing you. Come. Come to Him. Open your heart to Him and let Him come into your life. Let Him. You can't do it. Don't even think about, well, I've got to do this before I get in church. No, you don't. You just need to come to Jesus and let Him work. He'll do the cleaning. You let Him do the cleaning. You'll never clean it up. You'll just be in a bigger mess. But when He comes in, He'll clean you. He'll cleanse you. He'll touch you. He'll make it there, because He has the power to do that. I don't have the power to do that. I'm not God, He is. But I'm just His representative to let you know, if you'll open your heart to Him, He'll cleanse you. He'll touch you. He'll make a difference. And then He'll encourage you in your walk. It doesn't mean you're not going to make mistakes. We all do. There ain't a one in this house that hadn't made a mistake. If they did, they need to go to the altar if they say they haven't. You're the first one that needs to be here. Amen? Because we've all failed and come short. That's why we need God every day. Need Him and draw ourselves to Him. Because He's the cleanser today. He's the quicker picker-upper. Amen? Not Bounty. Jesus. Amen? He is what He is. And this is your opportunity. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, thank You. Thank You for Your living Word. Thank You, Lord, for the soul that was saved, the Philippian jailer. His life was changed. He took them in that hour and that night. He washed their stripes, and immediately, and all his family were baptized after they had spoke with him and been in the house with Paul. When they had brought them into the house, he set food before them, and they rejoiced, having believed in God with all their household. My, what a change. Lord, that's what You do. You turn us around completely to go in the direction, God, that You are leading. Lord, we just ask, Lord, we're going to take just a short time to respond before we share in communion together. And if there's anyone here that has a need, God, let them come to You. Let them come to You, Lord God, today. Just reach out to You, God, because You're reaching out to them. And God, we give You the praise and the glory for all that You're doing in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Let's stand together as we sing, as we play for just a response here. Whatever the Lord has laid. And then in just a few minutes, we're going to ask our deacons to come, and we're going to get ready to serve. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. we on? Okay. We're going to begin our communion time here. Do as we always do. We have ushers in the aisle, and they will escort you, and you will go, if you're in the middle, you'll go either one side or the other. You go all the way through and come around and go back to the aisles to your seat. And once everybody's received and back to your seat, then we'll partake of this communion together, okay, in the Lord. Isn't this a great time? He said, this do in remembrance of me. I'm constantly reminded every day when I get up of what Jesus done for me. I can't get away from it. It's what keeps me going. Are you here? What he done was tremendous. I could never, never repay him. But he did it for me. He did it for you. And he's alive. He resurrected. He's alive. He's out at him. He's living. And that's why we come and we're reminded of what he's done and his work. And I praise God for that. For his bread, the body, and for the wine that represents his blood. Praise be to God. Let's come at this time, would you? As the ushers lead. Just follow the ushers.